video, we traveled along the timeline from the 1800s to the 1950s, looking at the practices and policies that influenced and were influenced by redlining.
Today, we'll pick up where we left off to better understand how these policies of the past influenced the implementation of urban renewal, slum clearance, and the Community Reinvestment Act in the United States and in the city of Des Moines.
By the end of the 1950s, American cities began to evolve as the federal government started to fund projects across the United States in support of advancement and progress. The federal government gave cities billions of dollars to tear down blighted areas and replace them with better, more modern areas that had good quality affordable housing. At least, that was what was intended. These federally funded programs were called urban renewal. Along with urban renewal, the interstate highway system was in the beginning stages of mass expansion across the United States, connecting more places and expanding the capacity of cities. The urban renewal program came to Des Moines around 1957, when discussions about new highways and the clearing of neighborhoods for new development arose. In Des Moines, the urban renewal process worked its way through predominantly low-income and African-American neighborhoods, whose residents were treated poorly in terms of good communication and aid in finding new housing after displacement. At this time, the Des Moines Black population was thriving, but their housing situation was less than ideal. Due to the policies of redlining and the tactics of real estate agents and lenders, as you learned about in the last video, the Black population in the city was segregated by the 1950s. A 1956 Des Moines Register article states that Des Moines has segregated Negro housing that is nearly 100% effective, and that real estate brokers, the lending agencies, and the builders are holding the invisible border. The presence of just one Negro family in a block transforms the particular group of housing overnight into what the real estate broker labels a mixed neighborhood. The segregation in Des Moines was rampant, and many whites were content. However, Robert Spiegel, a journalist at the Des Moines Register, wrote countless articles recounting stories of discrimination and segregation across the city. His determination to get this topic into the hands of white readers pushed the conversation across the region. But there was not much desire to shift policy or practice. Des Moines had two major urban renewal projects. The first was the River Hills Renewal Area, and the second was the Oak Ridge Renewal Area. Together, these projects displaced upwards of 1,300 families, and with the construction of I-235, even more lost their homes and businesses. The process of urban renewal was long, and the government gave advance warning to all the neighborhoods in the path of these projects. This time ultimately allowed the government to continue disinvestment in these chosen neighborhoods, which in turn decreased the value and condition of the properties, and meant properties were unable to be sold. In the thick of urban renewal, those being displaced grew frustrated and upset with the city council for not providing them with good housing and a smooth relocation process. Those displaced received low appraisals for their homes and businesses, and were upset that the city did not offer them enough relocation compensation to buy comparable homes somewhere else in the city. Furthermore, white and black residents were not equally compensated for their properties. In 1959, an article from the Des Moines Register notes that the construction of I-235 would bulldoze around 1 mile, displacing about 400 families, many of which were African Americans. An interviewed individual noted that the freeway office had not kept its promise to give her another month to move to a house, and another interviewed family stated, "We were paid only $5,500 for our 3-bedroom house, and now are forced to buy a 2-bedroom house, not as good, for $9,500. When I checked with the Urban Renewal Board officials, I found that there were racial restrictions noted in their listings." The main problem facing African Americans was limited housing supply for their color, and when they tried to find housing, they had to pay more because of their race. As part of urban renewal, the government was supposed to aid those displaced or facing displacement to find housing. However, it was specified by the Council of Social Agencies that a major obstacle in the effective operation of an urban renewal program was to find adequate housing for all displaced families within the price range which a family could afford. It noted that while there were 212 rental vacancies in Des Moines, only 1% were available to African Americans, and if they applied for a rental property, the price of said property increased drastically. For example, from $65 to $80. Due to these limitations, moving anywhere with the same type of housing or better was impossible and forced African American families to live in areas with substandard housing. Along with the issues of unaffordable, adequate housing for African Americans, the urban renewal staff did not provide good communication. Many families moved before they could receive help from the urban renewal staff because of a lack of information. Urban renewal staff needed to take responsibility to keep those families informed about when displacement would happen and the options they had to secure standard housing. However, they were naive in how to deal with the different racial groups they were positioned to aid. This lack of communication led to hundreds of families being displaced without warning and without support from the government. One neighborhood that was impacted was Sherman Hill, located west of downtown Des Moines. Sherman Hill had seen disinvestment in the mid-20th century as white flight took hold, and with redlining pushing residents of color to certain parts of the city, it became an African-American neighborhood that grew into a cultural and economic epicenter along Center Street. The area had become the black side of town to whites in the city. Center Street had multiple blocks of black-owned businesses, including grocery stores, pharmacies, a funeral home, a hotel, barber shops, a beauty school, and a variety of other stores. The Center Street area also provided entertainment opportunities for the African-American population. For example, enjoying music at the Bilkin and Sepia nightclubs, and the neighborhood brimmed with activity. Center Street really was the heart and soul of the black community and the black economy in Des Moines. In the 1960s, I-235 and the Oak Ridge Area Urban Renewal Project displaced and destroyed substantial sections of this community. The Oak Ridge Project destroyed many buildings determined to be deficient and affordable, displacing over 180 people who had nowhere to go. So in 1966, the Des Moines Area Council of Churches discussed the potential for a nonprofit housing community that could serve the needs of low-income families in Des Moines, specifically those displaced by the Oak Ridge Project. Most of the black economic, social, and cultural life on Center Street was lost when the interstate came through. An area that had once served and supported the black community was bulldozed without second thought. Center Street's importance to the community was unmatched. Residents today recall their experiences on Center Street and the lively environment it provided. Some of the most talked about locations on Center Street were the jazz and social clubs.
We lived over on the east side, mm-hmm. 1753 Walker Street. Mm-hmm. And when the band would come through, like Count Basie and Louis Armstrong, and they would mm-hmm. be traveling cross country.
Right.
They all would call him and stop. Mm-hmm. If they got to Omaha, they would call him and say, you know, mm-hmm. we're only a couple hours away, you know, we want to come and, you know, mm-hmm. spend the night. And so they'd come, and we used to have jam sessions at our house. All the neighbors would come, and, mm-hmm. and it would be, you know, Dad and Count Basie playing together, and Louis Armstrong, and those guys would just come. And it was just like a household name. We never even took pictures because they were just my dad's buddies, you know? Yeah. I mean, it wasn't like...
In the River Hills neighborhood undergoing both urban renewal and freeway construction, the urban renewal staff created a table which showed the distribution of African Americans in that neighborhood. This found that 43% of non-white residents lived within the renewal boundary, and of that number, 12% were homeowners. Many black residents displaced from the River Hills renewal area only had a few places they were able to relocate. Black families were unable to find adequate housing in good neighborhoods as white realtors and residents made it impossible to move past certain invisible boundary markers. Urban renewal disrupted African-American neighborhoods throughout Des Moines, and with the poor communication from urban renewal staff, African-Americans were even more segregated than before. With this concentration in the inner city, the City of Des Moines considered the development of public housing and low-rent housing programs to aid the minority and low-income populations. However, those discussions were short-lived. While the public housing and subsequent programs would have greatly benefited the community, in 1961, the legislature defeated the public housing proposed bill. Again, in 1963, another bill was proposed for open occupancy housing to allow all residents to live anywhere in the city, but that was also defeated, despite the legislature approving a similar bill a few years earlier for urban renewal tracts. There was no desire to provide sufficient housing for minorities and low-income populations. In 1965, Iowa drafted a new Civil Rights Act, with two of its main sections being the creation of a Civil Rights Commission and the Discrimination in Housing Act. This law was enacted to ensure that sellers and landlords could not discriminate based on race, color, creed, sexual orientation, gender, familial status, disability, or national origin. While these laws were clear about mitigating discrimination in the legal realm, the true impact and enforcement of such policies were not done properly. The historic racism and segregation embedded in Des Moines neighborhoods allowed both local and federal laws to make no impact. African Americans protested continuing discrimination, and in 1966, a park located north of downtown was the site of a large riot between young African Americans and the Des Moines police. The young people involved in the riot were triggered by the constant confrontation and discrimination by the police department. When the riot happened at Good Park in July of 1966, some of the young people involved told the Des Moines Register that there was over-policing and many expressed concern about the rough police treatment. The riots occurred at a time when perceptions of police brutality were sparking riots across American cities. Many African Americans who had few economic opportunities grew impatient with the slow progress of the mainstream civil rights movement. This rioting came at a time when African Americans were starting to be infused by the rhetoric of Black Power, which would become more prominent a couple of years later. An active Black Power organization in Iowa emerged in Des Moines around 1968. This organization was the Des Moines Black Panther Party, led by Mary Rehm, a young woman who had left Des Moines in 1967, just after her high school graduation, and had headed for Oakland, California, where the headquarters of the National Black Panther Party was growing. In 1968, she came back to Des Moines and, alongside Charles Knox, founded the Black Panther Party in the city of Des Moines, with the intention of promoting and developing Black power in the community, which meant the economic, political, and cultural control of the Black community by Black people. The Des Moines Black Panther chapter understood and used the practices established by the national organization in California, but only addressed the things that were relevant to African Americans in Des Moines. The party only lasted until 1970. But its influence on Des Moines, both Black and white, was evident. It is said that while the larger community was uncomfortable with Black Power rhetoric, it was acknowledged that the party's programs, demonstrations, and posturing spurred the city towards more equitable employment of Black citizens. While Black communities were fighting for their rights and pushing back against racist housing and social policies across the United States, the federal government started to implement new, updated policies that would work to mitigate the past injustices, or at least, that was the intention. The construction of the interstate highway system and urban renewal programs completely changed the landscape of American cities. Mass transit allowed for suburban communities to thrive and ultimately cut off African Americans and other minorities who may not have had access to cars. While practices like redlining and other discriminatory policies were made illegal in 1968 with the passage of the Fair Housing Act, which prohibited housing discrimination on the basis of race, color, national origin, or religion, it didn't mean these practices were gone. As discrimination in the lending system continued subtly behind closed doors, new measures were taken in the early 1970s which attempted to address the continued discrimination. The Equal Credit Opportunity Act of 1974 prohibited discrimination on the basis of race or color, religion, national origin, sex, marital status, or age, among other factors. Both the Fair Housing Laws and the ECOA helped to curtail illegal redlining, where lenders, intentionally or otherwise, provided unequal access to credit based on personal characteristics rather than creditworthiness. But again, that didn't mean housing discrimination stopped. By the late 1970s, formerly redlined neighborhoods continued to see disinvestment and discrimination in lending practices. Cities were experiencing urban decline as companies were leaving city limits for the suburban communities, and the wealthier white families followed. This led to decreasing taxes across cities, and decisions of funding came into question. Starting in New York City, a public policy initiative was developed to address the decline by taking away core services from specific areas of the city that were experiencing urban blight or urban decay. The areas that were cut off from core services like police patrolling, garbage removal, fire services, healthcare access, street repairs, clean water access, and more, were low-income minority communities that were formerly redlined. Roger Starr, the Housing and Development Administrator of New York City, suggested during a speech to specifically close firehouses and schools. He felt that these areas were devastated by financial problems, and the best option to save money was to get rid of certain programs in the inner city. This was called planned shrinkage. However, this led to a plethora of problems in these neighborhoods. Without the necessary civil services, the targeted neighborhoods experienced violence, fire, and health epidemics, which devastated not only the communities living there, but cities at large. As urban decay continued and unequal lending practices plagued minority and low-income communities across the country, community groups from Chicago led a movement to change lending practices that were overtly discriminatory. The movement spurred Congress in 1975 to pass the Home Mortgage Disclosure Act, which required banks to disclose the location of the property financed and the race and gender of borrowers. While this was a move in the right direction, there were still many barriers and factors inhibiting lending into low and moderate income communities. By 1977, conversations about this topic continued and led to the proposal of the Community Reinvestment Act. In October of that year, President Jimmy Carter signed the bill into law. This law was enacted to prevent continued redlining and to encourage banks and savings associations to help meet the credit needs of all segments of their communities, including low and moderate income neighborhoods and individuals. In implementation, 12 assessment criteria were established to evaluate how banks ascertained and responded to the credit needs of their communities, and assigned banks a rating based on how they met these criteria. The CRA was ultimately designed to encourage banks to help rebuild and revitalize communities through sound lending and good business judgment that benefits the banks and communities they serve. The Community Reinvestment Act, while successful in many ways, was and still is hotly debated, and to many, did not go far enough to help eliminate discriminatory lending practices in low and moderate income communities and communities of color.
How does this history lead us to the conditions of the modern American city? And where do we go from here? In our next video, we'll discuss how these past policies and practices have led us to gentrification and increased segregation in some cities. Additionally, we'll start to discuss how to build a more equitable model going forward.